Hello and welcome to The Works. I'm Ben Peltier.
And I'm Ben Che. Last year, in a series of online programs, jazz composers, lab guitarist, composer and producer Alan Kwan invited musicians to talk about improvisation, composition and jazz appreciation. This year, a second series is underway and features a band and five other local musicians, including Ram Jang, who spoke to him about the blues. He'll be joining us later in the studio.
Hong Kong's skyline, dominated by high-rises and skyscrapers, is one of the most iconic in the world, particularly when night falls and vivid neon colors the streets. For Derry Ainsworth, who arrived here in 2014, the city's visual appeal was a major factor in persuading him to move out of his planned career in architecture and to take up photography. Yeah. Derry Ainsworth came to Hong Kong in 2014. At first, having earned his UK degree in architecture, he worked here in the same field. But Hong Kong's visual character, very different from that of his hometown in Bournemouth, increasingly drew him to photography.
When I first arrived in Hong Kong, I got my job in architecture, and photography was something that I hadn't really learned properly, so I was doing it on automatic mode, and I was using my camera on weekends and any spare time that I got to try and learn how to use it properly. And it was really the city that inspired me to use it properly. For me, I think you can see from the pictures I'm very building focused. I seem to be drawn towards perspectives of like urban scenery and urban landscape. But I like all the stuff that happens within those scenes as well. One particular notable one is the things that they call dragon gates in the buildings, and they're meant to give way to good feng shui. It's good for feng shui design that allows the wind to pass through the hole in the middle, or a dragon to pass through if they were to attack, supposedly. But I find it really unique and interesting in Hong Kong that that's still part of design of like modern day skyscrapers. And it's really cool to shoot that and kind of use the building as a frame. So in some of my photos, I try to capture something passing through that gap and use that gap as a frame to frame something. I've waited for like boats, for example, to come past in the sea behind it. And I wait for the right moment and capture it from a distance with like a frame.
I was gonna say this one.
I like the daily life of people in Hong Kong, kind of being like a fly on the wall, doing street photography and capturing people like really going about their day, living in context of where they are. And I find it so interesting. Like, obviously I still kind of feel like an alien. Like I wasn't born and raised in Hong Kong, so this stuff still really interests me. But for me to keep interested, I like to change it up a bit. I like to do a bit of aerial drone work, or I like to do street photography, or some days it's urban, some days it's mountains, hiking. It just depends on what sort of mood I'm feeling in, I guess.
A self-taught photographer, Ainsworth initially had to save money to buy cameras and equipment, but has, over the years, found increasing success as a commercial photographer. Like many in Hong Kong, he lives in a small apartment. He says he particularly likes shooting in busy districts such as Sham Shui Po because it's easier to capture local people's lives there.
Hong Kong is such a dense city that seeing it from above is very spectacular, it's very unique. Seeing that sort of complex density in the urban landscape is really cool from above, and you can capture some really interesting angles with a drone. Particularly here in Sham Shui Po, you've got some amazing like horizons of just ongoing endless buildings, and it looks really cool from above. I ended up calling one of my photographs Legoland because when you see it from a certain angle, you've got quite square looking buildings and they've got a lot of color as well. So if you increase the saturation on the photo, it does look like Legoland. I've lived my first 5 years here in Hong Kong Island, and last year I moved to Mong Kok. And I wanted to stay in Kowloon because I'm always out here taking street photography. and I like to be away from the hustle and bustle of the city in central or Shenguan, somewhere like that. I've seen it, I've been there. For me, I find this sort of place more authentic Hong Kong, and I can get around to like new territories or wherever, or other parts of Kowloon, east, wherever I want to go shoot, it's quite accessible from Sham Shui Po.
One aspect of Hong Kong's urban landscape that particularly appeals to him is its neon lighting. He has wandered through many of Hong Kong's neighborhoods photographing the brilliantly colored night scenes.
There's a nice neon sign here. It looks really cool next to these palm trees. And usually when it's wet like this, you can get a really nice reflection of the neon sign in the palm trees. And so you can sort of like double the image up. And sometimes if you're lucky, you've even got kids playing basketball here, which make for like a really good subject matter in the front of the picture. I think to enhance some of the colors of the neon signs and to try and give a more moody effect to the pictures, especially at night, I try and use like cooler tones, so more bluey. Try and bring out some of the colors of the neon signs. But yeah, try not to do too much editing. A lot of what you see is what you get here. And it looks very pretty and very scenic and by the harbor front, so it doesn't need too much editing.
In his personal projects, Ainsworth adds a new dimension to his images by using photo editing software to edit, composite, and animate his photos frame by frame, layer by layer. Last September, at the first edition of Digital Art Fair Asia, of which he's the creative director, he showcased his photographic prints and NFT art from his Collected Memories series. In March, one of his NFTs, Concrete Jungle, in the Collected Memories series, was sold at Sotheby's.
The interesting thing about that is that I couldn't decide which photographs I wanted to make as NFTs. And so I kind of tried jokingly to put them together. And what I really liked the result, and I was like, okay, this might work. And the first one that I tried and showed it to public was at Digital Art Fair. And that one sold, and it was great. Everyone was taking pictures with it, taking selfies with it, because it was up on the wall, a nice big picture collage. But it's cool because everyone was pointing to different bits in the picture, being like, oh, I know where that is. I was like, oh my God, is that a cat in Sham Shui Po? Oh my God, I can't figure out where this is. And that was really cool. It kind of had this, it has this sense that everyone can relate to a little bit of the picture. And I quite liked watching people try to do that. And I started to realize the value of NFTs was far more than I thought. People see it as the new form of collecting digital art, and it's a new form of appreciating digital art, which has not always had the platform that traditional art has had. So it was cool to see how the space was evolving. And then I took my style of just normal photographs and I tried to bring them to life a little bit. So some of my works at the beginning are like animated photographs. And now more recently, I've been doing this series called Collected Memories, which is basically like a big collage series of all of my favorite photographs from Hong Kong from my last 7 years.
In the 20th century, many pioneering Chinese artists spent at least part of their career studying abroad. From Lin Fengmian, Xu Beihong, and Sanyu in the 1920s, to Zao Wou-ki, Wu Guangzhong, and Chu The-chun in the 1940s and 1950s. The influence of the insights and experiences gained there on Chinese painting and sculpture was significant. Among those artists was Chao Chung-hsiang.
Chao went to study in Spain in 1956, settling in New York 2 years later and living there for most of the rest of his life. He merged influences from Western styles such as Abstract Expressionism, Cubism, and Action Painting with those of classical Chinese painting. His subjects range from flowers, fish, and birds to the cosmos and the purely abstract. On show at Alisan Fine Arts until June, Rediscovering Chao Chung-hsiang is the gallery's ninth solo exhibition of the artist. Welcome back. Last year, the Leisure and Cultural Services Department launched an online jazz program, Jazz Composers Lab, featuring jazz guitarist, composer, and producer Alan Kwan. In the program, Kwan invited musicians to talk about different jazz styles, approaches, and music appreciation. The program is now back for a second series with 12 online episodes. This time, Kwan spoke to 5 musicians and a band. One of those musicians is blues guitarist and singer Ram Jung.
Ram Jung, welcome to The Works.
Hello, Ben.
So people know you as a blues guitarist and vocalist. I want to start by asking you, how did you get into the blues and why the blues for you?
In the beginning to play guitar, just like some ordinary guitar players, and I'm start from playing some rock and pop music. And then one day when I walk into a CD store and there were some displays and recommendation CD on the corner, I spotted a blues compilation album and I tried to listen to. And then, I thought, that's what I'm looking for.
Right, yeah. The sound that you've been looking for.
Yeah.
Apart from being a performer, and musician, you're also very passionate about promoting the blues. You want to tell the public about the blues. Why is that? Why is that important for you?
I don't really say I'm promoting the blues. I'm just persist in doing what I love. Mm. And of course, I like playing in some intimate venues. I like cafes and some cultural space, and so I can get close to the audience, tell some stories about the blues, some blues man, and the story behind the songs. Yeah, so it's to let the audience discover more about the beauty of the blues music.
Right. And speaking of sharing the blues with the audience, you recently took part in the LCSD Jazz Composers Online. Tell us about that. Like, what was that about?
I was invited by my friend Alan Kwan. He's a jazz guitarist, musician, and presenter of this program. Oh. He invited me to share my composition. Although it's a jazz program, and I'm so glad to I have the chance to talk about blues in this program. I'm also a jazz lover, and I'm love to learn, love to study some jazz theory, jazz music, and apply them into my blues playing.
Mm. Let's talk a bit more about that, the relationship between jazz and blues, because many people think blues is the same as jazz. Can you explain the difference between blues and jazz?
Blues and jazz is like a brotherhood. Blues uses a more simple way to express emotion, and jazz more emphasize on create some innovation of harmonies and rhythm. Blues is an element of jazz.
Of jazz. Yes. This year, you are releasing your debut album.
Yes.
So can you tell us what inspired you to create an album and what's going to be in the album?
I'm playing blues over decades. Mm. And I really enjoyed to play and reinterpret some classic blues standards.
Yep.
But in these few years, so many things happen, not only in our society, but the whole world, especially the COVID things. Mm. It makes me kind of suffering. And I think it's time to write some songs to express my blues. The songs in this album is like a summary. It's like a summary and conclusion to reveal my different kind of blues style that influenced me. And I will have a guest harmonica player to play some acoustic Delta blues with me. And also, I play with my six-piece band, shake that thing called. Yeah, we have some big arrangement, especially some horn section, and play some, and we'll play some upbeat and jump blues style stuff. I will have some blues ballad with some piano arrangement, and I have another guest piano player too. One track of mine is like a little bit jazzy and modern blues stuff, and I got Mr. Du Xin Pao to play a guitar track for me.
Right.
Yeah, it's so excited.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Well, finally, Ram, you're here, and we would love to hear some blues from you. So what tune would you like to play for us in the studio? And tell us a bit more about this song.
I'm going to play a tune called I First Met Her. It will appear in my album. Yeah. It's a blues ballad, and it talks about how I met my love. Yeah. I met her in my difficult time. I want to express how I cherish this love.
Well, I'm looking forward to hearing it. Thank you for coming in, and let's hear the song then.
Thank you.
One day I looked up, the sky was dizzying gray. I took a picture to remember such a day. Then I met my friends and I at the same old place. Then I first met the day on that day. Little by little, she has stared into me. I had a feeling, perhaps this meant to be. But I know, if I let her go, I'll remain in misery. Now she came to me and assumed the pain in me. I wonder if we never met on that day. How could I get through all the desperate nights and days? But I know something does take time to wait. And now I begin to believe in fate.